Good. How are you?
I'm very well, John. How are you?
I'm okay. I'm feeling
I know. I
moderately better.
heard you were not so good last week.
No. No, it's not a nasty thing to catch. Have you caught anything remotely like that or?
No, I haven't. I've been very lucky.
No.
But I know, I know two or three people who have, and it just wiped them for six.
Well, it's all a little unclear, but anyway, yes, and how have you been keeping?
I've been keeping okay. I mean, it's been a weird year, obviously. No need to say that, really.
No. I think actually this year is the first time that I've heard the word unprecedented, and I can't stop hearing it now. It's the, I've
Oh,
heard
I know.
unprecedented an unprecedented amount of times, I feel.
Yes. Yeah, you probably have. Yeah, for sure. I'm a bit of a one of those stay-at-home people, actually. I guess because I've spent so much of my life traveling. If I get the chance to be at home, someone says, "Oh, come down to London." I'm like, "Oh, London, that's 40 miles away. Am I sure I want to invest all that time in traffic?"
Exactly.
So sitting at home and having a quiet Christmas, I was kind of, well, this is going to be great. I could just watch all the films I want.
There you go.
So
Yeah, you
I did.
Well,
I
is it?
watched Elf every day.
Did
It was
you on
fantastic.
repeat? Yeah.
Well, it felt like it.
Oh, yes,
Yeah.
it's quite a quotable film, isn't it? Elf, I think.
Yeah, it's not bad of the Christmas films.
Indeed, indeed.
So, anyway, but we're not here to talk about Elf, are we?
No.
Although we could
No.
spend a
Wouldn't it be
while.
funny if we handed this chat over and absolutely nothing to do with your new album?
Yeah, talking of a new album, I think I have a new album.
You have a new album. Yes,
Yeah,
indeed.
I
So,
do.
just for a bit of a perspective, when did you when did when? Because I know what, how this, I know what it, traditionally you kind of wrap an album, don't you? And then like 6 months goes by, whilst it sits in the release pattern, and then you forget all about it. When did you guys knock it on the head, as it were? When was it completed?
Well, it's in a way it's still being completed
Oh, is it?
because no, I mean it's just been finished actually. It's taken, as these things do when you have time, it's taken as long as the time we've had. So normally, because our schedules are all quite busy, we don't have any time. So we literally will go in the studio for 2 weeks, 10 days to 2 weeks. 2 weeks is a bit of a luxury for Transatlantic. And then we'll spend the next month putting all our overdubs on and working out harmonies and that sort of thing and send it off to be mixed. It will get released and we'll go on tour with it when we can. But with this one, because nobody was going on tour, it just took a long, long time. And because we were kind of deliberating and thinking
Can I just
about
hold you there
how.
one sec, Pete? Somebody's at my door. Unbelievably, I haven't heard from anybody all week. Just hold the phone.
I shall hold on. That bloody John Mitchell. It'll be Amazon. He buys ever such a lot of stuff on Amazon. It's probably a whole bunch of stuff from Mandalorian. It'll be another 10 boxes of Baby Yodas, I should think. Oh, sorry, were you listening?
No, I haven't got any baby Yodas, in fact.
Have you not? Oh,
I've
come
collected pretty
on.
much everything else in the world, as you can see behind, but no baby Yodas.
Oh,
Yes.
pardon me.
No, that was sorry. That was. Do I want to sponsor a cat? And I've got my hands full of cats already. I don't need to sponsor another one.
No, you've got enough cats, haven't you?
Yes, indeed.
So, getting, yeah,
Oh yeah, going back to the album, you decamped to Sweden, I understand.
so yeah, I mean to well to carry on the thread I was on, I mean it took as long as the time we had, and because of COVID and because of lockdown in most countries, there was no touring going on. There was no need to have a release date because we weren't going to be able to tour anything. And that allowed us to tinker about with the album. But more of that later, because let me go back to how it all started.
right to the beginning. How did Transatlantic start, or how this album started?
I was going to
ask you about the history of Transatlantic. I know how the name came about. I think I read an interview with you somewhere whereby you all, to my Transatlantic friends, I think you started, there was an email thread. And that gave
I think it was Rainer that started the thread.
Right.
We were looking for a name, ironically.
Yeah.
And Rainer said, to my transatlantic friends, here's a list of names. And I think it was Mike that replied, actually, I like transatlantic.
There you go. And was the list of names any good? Was there anything, nothing?
Well, the thing about names is that you never know until you try one out, do you? It's a bit like a new shirt.
Well, exactly. Like this one.
like the one you're wearing.
My special Christmas shirt that I put on for the occasion.
Is it a lucky shirt, John?
I don't know yet. I mean, if this records and it ends up being usable, then I guess it will be a lucky shirt.
I guess it will. So, yeah. So, the band... okay, well, let me start with the history of the band then. So, the band was formed by Mike. Mike had this idea when he was still in Dream Theater. He wanted to have a project. Now, he'd had two or three projects in the past.
Yeah, he's got liquid.
But he fancied getting together with some of his kind of favorite musicians.
Yeah.
And that was Neil Morse from Spock's Beard.
Yeah.
Because that was one of his kind of favorite bands. Rainer from the Flower Kings.
Yeah,
and for some reason he chose me.
Oh,
I knew Mike more than the other two because Dream Theatre supported Marillion back in the 80s.
Yeah,
so Mike, on the bottom of another email about another thing entirely, said, by the way, would Pete? This was an email to the band about some stuff that Steve Rothery and Steve Hogarth did with Dream Theatre. He put at the bottom of the email, by the way, can you ask Pete if he'd like to be part of a project?
Yeah.
So they said, would you like to be part of a project? And I said, well, what do you guys think? And they said, we think you should do it. So I joined Mike.
The Marillion guys said, Steve.
Yeah, the Marillion guys all kind of said, yeah, you should do it. It'd be a good idea.
Yeah.
So a studio was arranged. Inside Out were going to put up some money. Radiant Records, Neil's company, was going to put up some money.
Yeah.
And we were going to go away. Let me get this right. It's 99.
Yeah.
Something like that. Let me have a look at the first album. When was the first album released? I never look at albums. And I can't read the release date. Oh, goodness me. Well, anyway, so what was supposed to happen?
So this was before Inside Out got involved. It was actually put together apropos of just you guys.
No, Inside Out were going to be involved.
Okay.
At this point. So they put some money up. Neil Morse's record label had put some money up.
Right.
And we were going to go to this little studio in upstate New York.
Yeah.
However, before we got there,
yeah,
I was hit by a car and broke my leg.
I do remember that.
Places.
Yes.
And so I was lying in hospital round about my birthday, my 40th birthday. So yeah. I should be able to work out these dates, but I can't.
No, that's okay. It's a rough...
I was lying in bed thinking, well, that's the end of that then. But I got a message through. Somebody gave me a message saying, oh, by the way, we're going to hold on. We're going to hold off and postpone the recording.
Yeah.
So I thought, well, that's very nice of them. So they waited till I was kind of in a fit state to fly.
Yeah.
So, and I'd had a few conversations with Mike about this because I'd been sent demos by Rainer and by Neil.
Yeah.
And some of this, particularly Neil's stuff, was quite kind of, there was a lot of shredding.
Yeah.
Or a lot of kind of busy stuff that I'm not really a busy player. I'm much more of a hang in and play a nice melody around, what's going on. So I was thinking, so I phoned up Mike, or I got in contact with Mike and said, are you sure? Are you sure I'm the right person for this? He says, yeah, totally. He said, what I want is to capture is, you know, how we all play together.
Yeah.
I don't want you necessarily to be outside your comfort zone. Just do what you do.
Yeah.
What you do is great, you know.
So, and the shredding was, I mean, presumably, so this was Neil. I mean, he plays various.
Yeah, Neil did a demo of one of his songs, and it had this kind of keyboardy, solo-y thing, and the bass was following along with it. You know how these things go.
Sort of,
all very fast.
Mr. Big, they made that popular, didn't they? Where the bass.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it was very impressive, but I was thinking, well, it sounds more impressive than I'd probably make.
You were thinking, how am I going to play that?
Exactly, yeah.
Welcome to my world in Frost.
It's fine in recording trickery, you know, but when you have to play it live, I was thinking.
Yeah.
So anyway, that was sort of, so that was taken out of the, you know, that Mike was quite, oh, don't worry about all of that, we'll sort that out, you know.
Yeah.
So when I was fit enough to fly, I flew to America with two bases, a case, and I was on crutches with a plaster on my leg.
Goodness.
So Fiona took me to the airport,
yeah,
and then kind of helped me to get as far as she could. And then, but I tell you what, the airline, I think it was BA.
I would expect no
less. The airline were terrific. They were really, really good, and they really looked after me.
Yeah.
And the bases ended up in one piece as well, which was always a bonus.
Yeah, you normally have to book an extra seat, don't you, if you want to ensure that they arrive.
Yeah, well, I flew them. I flew them in the hold. I, you know, undid this.
I did, like, yeah.
Slackened the strings off and prayed.
Took the neck off, stuck it in a suitcase.
I didn't do that, but I have seen bands do that.
Yeah, I did thinking, that.
Did you?
Yeah, I did that. I did a couple of festival dates with Fish, and I wasn't trusting of the. We kind of flew out there
usual style.
He didn't have excess baggage, basically. So I took it upon myself to take the neck off and shoved a Boss GT100 or something into a suitcase, and that was me done. So there we go.
I mean, it's great that you can do that, but I don't really trust. Well, actually, the bass I was using, it's a Warwick, and it was a through neck, so I couldn't take the neck off anyway.
No.
It would have involved a saw.
Yeah.
And I didn't fancy woodwork, you know.
No.
I didn't get that far in woodwork to trust myself.
No, me neither.
So anyway, I arrived there, and I was thinking, we're never going to record an album in a week. I mean, you know, Marillion take months, sometimes years.
Yes.
To,
you've told me
to
the
come
process.
Up with albums, and Mike had been saying, "Oh yeah, it's easy. Yeah, of course we can. We just, you know, start playing." And I'm thinking, well, "What are we going to play then? You know, and how are we going to do this?" But actually, it worked out really well.
Yeah.
And you know, so we sat down, listened to everybody's stuff. I didn't actually have any music because I hadn't even thought about writing music at that stage within Transatlantic. I just brought myself. I'm here, this is me, you know. And so we kind of decided to start with one of Neil's songs called All of the Above, and it had various little song sections in it. And I was thinking, I hope we're not going to have supposed to memorize 30 minutes of music and then play it, because I'll come very unstuck. So I suggested we do it in piecemeal, you know, stages, so it's sort of 5 minutes chunks at a time,
edit section,
which is what we did.
Well, at the end of the first, isn't it?
Huh?
That's how Yes used to record. They used to, like, you know, when they did Close to the Edge, they'd come off to, I mean, you know, it's kind of bizarre. I read somewhere that they'd all set up and record together, and then break it all down, go off and do a gig, then come back and stand. It's like, it's amazing that those songs actually sound at all consistent, but it's
the
genius
great
of
work Offord. From Eddie Offord. Really.
Yeah, that the fact they all stitched together, you know. But you know, can't imagine playing Close to the Edge in a one, can you? You know, well, obviously,
absolutely not. But, not when you're writing it. No,
certainly not when you're writing it.
So that's what we did, and that allowed us to, at the end of 5 minutes or a natural, you know, the end of a song or a chorus or whatever. We could stop and ponder and think, well, does it want to go to the next bit, or do we want to do something else?
Yeah.
And we quite often found ourselves breaking out into other little bits and pieces that I got more involved in. one of them being Camouflaged in Blue.
Yeah,
which was kind of bass driven, I suppose.
I remember we played that with the Jeff Henry.
Yeah, we did. We did. It's a great little. It's a nice little thing. So that was. And, you know, at the end of the week, we had, or the end of 7 or 8 days, we had the first album, which, right. And then, of course, we took it, we had the bare bones of it, you know.
Yeah.
So then we took it away, I had the luxury of recording my bass. I can't remember. I think I managed to record, because Mike was really quick on the drums.
Yeah.
He was kind of, we were just basically recording the drums as we went.
Yeah.
And he would, anything he wanted to repair, he'd just repair straight after the day.
Yeah.
And the next morning, I would be up and, because we were in a residential studio. Mm. So I would be up and overdubbing bass. And so then when it was taken away by everybody, I added harmonies and oohs and ahs and, you know, all sorts of stuff.
Yeah.
And that was the first album. It was fairly sparse listening to it all now. The second album, we toured the first album in America. I don't think we toured the first album in England.
Yeah.
Or Europe, in fact. The second album, we went to a studio. We started out at Neil's with the second album. We had a bit more time on our hands. I think we had 3 weeks together. Mm. And we started at Neil's and arranged and actually did a little demo of what we were going to record. And then we went to a studio just outside of Nashville, which is amazing. It was an old fort type building. And it had a live room. It kind of had a live studio vibe, a bit like Real World does. It was very expansive room with a desk at one side.
Yeah.
I believe that was one of the rooms. And then we all set up and recorded the drums and a basic backing tracks on what we'd arranged.
Yeah.
And that was a bit more fun. I'd actually written two or three pieces of music for that album as well, which ended up being used. So that was a bit more fun. It was it was a lot more fun just being able to talk about what we were going to arrange and how we were going to arrange it, because it's a fast and furious process, but it's nice to mess about with the music before you actually commit.
Because there's a million permutations
absolutely.
When Eddie mentions going straight into a studio and recording, the band Queen springs to mind. There's a kind of, but they didn't have just turn up and book a studio. Nobody had a single idea for what they were going to do. But I suppose when you're Queen and you got that amount of cash flying around, you can afford that luxury. But,
And also, all of Queen are writers as well. So that makes it a bit quicker.
Yeah.
Because I quite often... I kind of wondered about that sort of thing. Elton John used to just turn up and, he'd have the lyrics that he'd been sent from Bernie Taupin, and he'd just start playing and, oh, that sounds quite good.
Yeah.
Let's call it Yellow Brick Road.
I think he did your song. Is it your song? I'm terrible with names. He did it in about 10 minutes.
No, your song or my song.
No, the Elton John song. Elton John song, your song.
Right. I think I've got that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and I think he wrote it in about 10 minutes. And he just got, like you say, he got the lyrics faxed over and off he went. It's quite remarkable to think about it. But, when you get a streak, like he had a fantastic streak at the start of, at the start of the 70s, didn't he? He was on fire.
He did. He really was. Yeah. So then, the third album, The Whirlwind, we recorded at Neil's place. Neil's got quite a big, he'd sort of remodeled a bit of his house and had an extension and put a studio on.
Yeah.
And we recorded there, and that was nice. I really enjoyed that session. The Whirlwind, I think, because we'd had a bit of a break from each other. We'd had about a sort of 7 or 8 year break or 10 year break from what I remember. It was nice to be back together. It was like oh, here we are all back together, and enjoying ourselves, which was nice. And we had some very strong ideas. we'd all written ideas and sent them round to each other.
Yeah.
For the Whirlwind, and that really helped, because we all had notes on what we wanted to use, and made it a little bit easier to decide how we were going to approach the recording of that.
Yeah.
That album. And I stayed at Neil's house as well, which was quite nice.
Yeah.
Made it less, you know, when you're staying residentially or you're staying in a hotel or whatever, it's just can get a bit soul destroying, you know.
Yeah.
So actually being in a bit more of a sort of family environment was nice.
Well, absolutely. I mean, environment is everything, isn't it? I mean, you know, when you
You've got to be comfortable. Yeah,
you can say that, you know, certainly. I mean, you know, I mean, you've made albums all over the place. I mean, I read that you obviously back in the day you recorded in Berlin, and you said that I think I read that you said that was quite oppressive in a way, that the surroundings were quite bleak.
It was. it was very bleak. I mean, it was fascinating at the same time. And it was kind of a scary place, Berlin, because it was West Berlin and East Berlin.
Yeah.
And the Hansa Studio was right on the edge of the wall. So you could look over the wall and see all the soldiers on the other side.
Yeah.
And all that, you know, there were helicopters flying around, both, you know, American helicopters and Russian helicopters guarding their perimeters of the wall day and night. And, you know, and the sense of people living in the West, there was a sense of this could all end any time.
Yeah.
So let's make today count, you know. Yeah, so there was a lot of partying. It was a party town. It was quite a young town as well, because you could avoid the draft. If you opted at a certain age, if you opted to live and work in Berlin, you could avoid being drafted into the army. So there's tons of kind of young kids, and that's why, you know, a lot of the clubs and a lot of the nightlife sort of thrived, shall we say.
Yeah. Mm. What a time to be alive.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, no, it was good. It was good fun. It was good fun.
Yeah.
Anyway, moving on.
Atlantic.
To the Kaleidoscope. Yeah, Kaleidoscope was the last album before this one.
The fourth one.
And we recorded that. Again, I think we recorded it at Neil's.
Yeah.
And again, you know, we'd all written ideas for it, and it seemed to go, you know, it seemed to go quite well, recording wise. I think we had a few bumpy moments where we disagreed on things, but that's always going to happen. And the worst thing is it's a four piece, right? So you get people, you know, you get two people disagreeing and, you know, it's like, well, how do you resolve this? You know?
Yeah.
So we were always trying to find ways to resolve things without it being difficult for a working relationship.
Yeah. And that's probably the hardest thing about being in bands generally, you know, it's you try and...
People fall out about all sorts of things, don't they? Even, I mean, it's not so bad these days, because at least you can say, well, let's do more than one mix then, because you've got the option to have 20 mixes saved.
Yeah.
But I remember back in the day when you were on tape, it's like, if you didn't like a mix, bands would split up and bands would get into fights and all sorts of things.
Yeah.
You know, it's great watching a fight when you're spending £1,000 on a studio a day.
This is true. It's true.
Can you take that outside, but do it later, please?
Yeah.
Get on. Yeah,
it's you know, and it's, you know, it's, I suppose, you know, being quite the genre of music, I suppose, you know, progressive rock. I mean, it's quite, you know, there's a lot of emphasis on musicianship and everybody wanting to be heard in the mix. You know, it's kind of I always remember, you know, everybody went, again, going back to Yes, or, you know, reading that they used to sit there ferociously with their fader, not letting anybody...
That's right. I remember doing that, though. I remember doing that with Marillion when we were mixing it before you had Total Recall. we would have faders to ride up little bits that I didn't hear on the bass or whatever, or, you know. Oh, there's that little bit of snare where you don't quite hear the grace notes, you know, there's all that kind of stuff going on.
So, it's one of those things, isn't it? You know, having produced bands as I have done for quite a long time.
Oh, I know.
Trying to mediate everyone's, you know, And eventually you just want to go around, look, no one's singing the fucking, excuse my French, snare drum, are they?
Can you swear on the...
I don't know, but we've just given him a gig, a little, get the bleep button on. Yeah, you can always, yes, I mean, you know, sorry, I do.
Yeah, exactly, yeah, look. No one, and of course, the reality is, in 6 months' time, you're going to have forgotten what you were worried about.
Exactly.
I remember spending years thinking no one can ever hear the bass on Marillion albums. And I listen back now and it's like, well, it was fine, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
Probably where it should be.
Yeah. Yeah. You know,
I just wanted to big up my part, you know.
No, no, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, it's, yeah, but you, you know, certainly, you know, there is a lot of kind of leaving, having to leave one's ego at the door, isn't there, in the mix process, which, you know.
What we've always done with Transatlantic, actually, which is good, in I think, is that we've always left it to mix the mixing to Rich Mauser,
right,
in LA, and he's mixed all of the albums.
Yeah,
and he's got a great pair of ears, and luckily, he really is. He's kind of into bass.
Yeah.
So the bass is always fairly prominent on Transatlantic albums.
Well, so, yes, I mean, I'm just listening to the new album. You know, it is, and the tone of the bass is great as well. So, you know, I was listening through to.
Yeah, it is actually. I'm very lucky about that because I had to record the bass at home, which I'm going to tell you all about in a minute.
Okay.
I'm getting ahead. Move on to the absolute universe.
Yeah.
The new album.
Yes.
So yes, this album. So ever since the Kaleidoscope album, we've been kind of tentatively wondering when we'd get to back together. If we'd get back together, you know, is four albums, are we sort of done with this? Or is that, you know, what else would we do? Where would we go?
Yeah.
And about 2 or 3 years ago, when we were, I guess we met up on one of the cruise to the edges, ships, we started discussing, you know, do we want to do another album? And the answer, we all decided that it'd be a good idea.
Mm.
And we spent a couple of years just trying to find time because, you know what it's like,
yeah,
trying to fit schedules together when you've got people in various projects. It's very difficult. You know, the clouds have to part, the stars have to align, you know, all that goes on.
Yeah.
So we said, okay, let's try some point in 2019, because everybody's diaries were pretty full up into some point in a distant future, which happened to be the year 2019.
Yeah.
And we opted for the summer, but in actual fact, we ended up moving that back a little bit because the plan was to go to America to record again, but it was going to be very difficult for Reuner and myself with the regime that was in America at the time.
Yeah.
to get the necessary paperwork and it was also going to become quite costly. So we opted to go to Sweden, which was going to be an easier job for the two Americans to get to Sweden.
Easy to leave than to get into.
Yeah. Yes, probably. Yeah. So Reuner found a studio in the north of Sweden called Fenix Studio. And at the point in time when we decided to, you know, go for 2019, I actually started writing some music seriously for this album. And Neil had like 90 minutes of music he brought to the table. Reuner just had a bunch of songs. I mean, he had a list of 30 or 40 songs, all of which were kind of, some were weird, some were plain odd, and some were like a bit more straightforward, a bit more kind of normal. So there was a real collection of stuff that we could sort of dig into. We made a list of our favorites and went off to Sweden and started arranging it. And we thought at the time, because we had 10 days, I think, and we thought, well, we'll probably end up, you know, with the backing tracks again. But in actual fact, all we did, we spent the whole time arranging and kind of rearranging bits and pieces. And we started out about about two thirds in. No, about a third of the album in. We started out with, I'm just getting the track listing here together. We started out around Reach for the Sky, I think, which was, it was a verse of mine, actually. Musically, it's a verse of mine.
Yeah.
With a chorus of Neil's. I think it was originally going to be a song of Neil's, but my verse got put in there, which was nice.
Yeah.
And we kind of went on and put two or three things together, some of which was new, some of which was rejigged from what we had. And then we got to a kind of natural break and went back and decided that an overture would be a good way to start the whole album.
Yeah.
So then we started working on the overture.
Yeah.
And we'd already established two or three themes.
Yeah.
And we have a whiteboard, and so everybody's ideas were listed, and also listed in, is this a song? Is this a piece of music? Is this like a theme? Is it a solo thing? Whatever. So we already knew we had two or three big themes that we wanted to, put in amongst the songs and maybe bring back towards the end of the album as well, because that's another thing we quite like doing.
Yeah.
And at this point, we'd made the decision it was going to be one long piece of music. It was going to be a kind of conscious stream of thought, if you like.
Yeah.
Which I always find is much more fun, and I like working in that way.
Mm.
I just find it a lot easier with the sort of music we play.
Yeah,
and it stops you having to find make an end to a song.
Yeah, absolutely.
So
you're not. No one's allowed a fade out. the fade out.
Exactly. Yeah. No.
Fade out ended with the 80s.
You don't need to find some terrible way to end.
Yeah. Yeah. So you've got, but the thing that we should probably talk about that sets this album apart is the fact that there are completely two different versions of it. And
yeah, there are. Yeah.
And some, the lyrics, you've revisited some of the songs with different lyrics and different titles. Is that correct?
That is correct. Yeah. I mean, yeah, I should move on to that really, because that's the important and interesting feature of this album, is that it is actually two albums. Forevermore is the kind of extended version, as we call it. Yeah. And that is pretty much what we ended up leaving Sweden with.
Right.
Was, and it's sort of 80 minutes of a long song which goes through various high points and low points. Lots of themes, lots of, it's very transatlantic. It sounds, if you like what's transatlantic, we seem to have our own sound now. And so we were kind of aiming for that. We wanted to revisit what we'd captured.
I mean, the thing that strikes me is how, it's incredibly, there's a lot of very, very melodic themes, like at the end of Love Made Away. The rousing, that's a very lovely melody at the front of that,
It is, isn't it? That's a great piece. Neil comes up with some amazing things, some really lovely melodies.
Yeah.
And that was one of his. The Absolute Universe Forevermore is the extended version.
Yeah.
But then the other version is called, where's the title gone? It's above, isn't it? It's the Breath of Life.
Yeah.
The Breath of Life is the abridged version.
Sure.
Now, what happened, how this all came about, is that while we were in Sweden, we were talking about how long this should be. And Mike was like, this could be longer than The Whirlwind. And I'm thinking, The Whirlwind was 70 minutes of music.
Yeah.
And I said, well, are we sure we want it to be that long? And Mike and Neil were both, totally. We've got all this music. It'd be great to, really, really dig into it. And I'm thinking, I wondered if some of the bits might benefit from just being tightened up a little bit.
Mm.
So I was kind of outvoted because Royan was, you know, the consensus was, let's just leave it and see how it goes. We can always change things in an edit or whatever, you know, we decide to do. So we did that, and we took away with us Forevermore version. Yeah. And that's what we all started working on when we thought that, you know, we took it away. So we were recording in September, I think. We came back. I was away touring with Marillion, but basically we were all supposed to finish all of our recording by January.
Yeah.
Then it was going to come out and we were going to tour later that year, later this year, I guess.
Yeah.
Or early this year, which would have been probably 3 months after.
Yeah.
The album was given to the label. And of course, COVID took over.
It did. And
lockdowns happened, and everybody went through various phases of what they could do, what they couldn't do in their own countries.
Yeah.
So that meant that when I got round to my recording, one of the things that was an issue for me was I couldn't record in a studio. So I had to record my bass at home.
Yeah.
So I sneaked off to Marillion's studio and picked up my favourite Warwick bass. I thought, well, at least if I've got a good bass that I know I can rely on the sound of that.
Yeah.
I'll just record it straight into my computer. And I knew Royner had an Ampeg set up at his studio. He was going to reamp it for me.
Yeah.
So that was how we were going to work on that. Yeah. And we all just started working on Forevermore. We weren't really talking to each other. We were all doing it at different phases and in different times. And I guess we were all thinking, well, we've got a bit more time now, really, if we want it. And Royner was sending stuff through, and he'd sung different lyrics on one of Neil's songs, and Neil sent stuff through, and he'd done a similar kind of thing. So we were all, rather than making one thing, we're all sort of slowly drifting off in different directions with it. And then Neil sent an email through March time, maybe, saying, am I crazy? And he'd gone away on holiday and he'd come back. And he started listening to the album again and working on it and thought, you know what, I think this should be shorter than this. So he edited it, and he edited it in quite a specific way, which brought some of the themes from the end of the album to the front of the album. Although he'd had one of the themes that I'd written was only featured at the end of the album. So he spliced the tape and re-recorded that theme himself. He did a little demo that he put inside and said, well, look, this is, you know, he sent through this version of the album, which was about 10 minutes, 20 minutes shorter than Forevermore. But it had different music in it as well. And it had different versions of things. And because we'd done so much overdubbing at this point, you could really, you know, make two very different albums.
Yeah.
And then, of course, we had to sit down and decide what to do about that, whether we would, which one we'd use, which one we'd choose, and which one we'd work on. And once again,
democracy went out.
there was a two of us, 2v2 situation. So Mike said, well, look, rather than, you know, having to choose, why don't we make two albums? So we ran that past the record company and they said, well, you can't just edit an album and call it a different album. We said, but no, that's not what we're doing. We're actually making a very different piece of music, a very different experience, if you like.
Yeah.
Of the album. So that's what we did. And the lyrical, you know, there's more lyrical references on the Breath of Life to the situation we've all been through this year than Forevermore, because Forevermore was basically written before any of this happened with COVID.
So these are alternative lyrics on this, like just completely different.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So the lyrics are different.
So in actual fact,
song titles, songs are different. There's a song, for example, there's a song on there's a song on Breath of Life called where is it? It's here somewhere.
Can
You feel it? That's right. Yeah. There's a song called Can You Feel It on the Breath of Life.
3-4-1.
Yes. Yeah. Which is great, actually.
And, that's 2-3-4-1s.
Yeah. So Neil said, look, I really think that this, something like this should be here at this point.
Yeah.
On this version of the album. And so we all, it's like, yeah, okay then. So next available few minutes you have, you re-record over, you know, what Neil had sent us. And so we did quite a bit of that.
Yeah.
There was quite a bit of, I know you've recorded everything, but can you just go back and do this again or just do that? Or, oh, I've re-sung the little, I've rewritten all these lyrics, so we need to re-sing the harmonies. I said, oh, right, okay. we were touring, and rather than making an album in a week, which is kind of what we did with the first album, we've spent a year or more, probably more than a year on this album.
Yeah.
And in fact, the last bit of singing I did was for the first YouTube single, for Reaching for the Sky. I had to re-sing the choruses.
Yeah.
So that was,
The thing about the, obviously this band as well is that everybody sings, right?
Yeah.
And that kind of in itself brought a new...
We'll call it that, shall we? That's well, very kind sing, of you, John.
You sing the songs, the song Solitude, you sing that one.
I
have to be honest with you, I find it hard to differentiate between the tones. I can obviously, because I've known you for a long time, I know, you know, I know how you sound when you sing. And but I mean, yeah. I think that Neil has a sort of slightly raspy kind of, you know, he's got kind of, you know, and there's, you know, the tones seem between, I guess, the I always tell people's vocals by their vib more than anything. But
the
tones are quite. Yeah, but it's interesting. I mean, it's, you know, to have a band with like four people singing, you know, it's quite unusual in taking lead vocals rather, you know. Again, there's that sort of Queen parallel. I suppose everybody except John Deacon sung at some point or other in Queen, didn't they? You know, so it's,
yeah. Did he not sing? No, I guess he didn't. Did he? I should know.
No, I think you should see him on Top of the Pops with a mic in front of him, but I don't think it was necessarily ever. I think it was more of a totemistic thing than you
yeah,
know.
Exactly. Everyone else has got a mic. I want my mic. That's about, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's true. That's one of the great things about it live, actually, is that we can, because we all sing the, you know, you hear the harmonies from the live shows, and that is us singing.
Yeah.
You know, if one of us doesn't sing, it's just not there.
Yeah.
You know, as opposed to, oh, is somebody, who's singing that part then?
Yeah, yeah. Because I did actually.
Which is what you often find these days.
I came to see you at the Astoria when that was still around. I don't know if you remember that. And
yeah.
Young Daniel Gilden, though, sort of helping out on.
That's
sort of
right. Well, he was tremendous. I mean, he's a great singer.
Yeah.
He had a lot of stage presence, is what I'm going to say about that.
He was quite a mile away.
Upstaging me. And he was like, so tall as well. So even when he was behind me, it looked like he was in front of me.
Yeah.
So yeah, so I mean, it's a really exciting thing. This having done, you know, two versions of the album,
yeah,
or two albums, I should say,
yeah.
And I should probably mention that the 5.1 mix, which is a completely different mix itself,
is that for various, you mentioned earlier.
Yeah, obviously, I mean, 5.1s are a different mix by default, but what Mike did. Is that he sat down with Rich and put all his favourite bits from both of the albums into a 5.1 mix, which runs at about 100 minutes.
Yeah.
So that, again, is, if you want to be picky, you could say, well, there's three versions of the album. And yeah, and it's going to come out on the 5th of February.
The 5th of February. So not long.
5th of February is the release date worldwide.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And I guess there's no, I mean, in terms of videos and promotional tools, I guess it's been quite difficult trying to...
We have done some videos. We've done three. Well, we've done two so far.
Yeah.
We've done Reach for the Sky and another one called Looking for the Light. Looking for the Light.
Yeah, I have a few questions. I have to ask the song Belong. What on earth is the noise at the start of that song? It's a very unusual noise.
Oh, the vocal.
Yeah, it's
the
a vocal very,
noise.
I've never heard anything quite like that.
No, it's from, it's Tibetan.
Ah.
It's Tibetan singing, I believe.
Yeah.
It's like, and it's a, I think it's a female calling.
Right. It's very unusual.
Yeah, it's very unusual.
I was going, what on earth?
That was what, Rainer found it. Rainer found this and just thought, that's an amazing thing.
It certainly is.
And of course, Belong, Belong, you know, it's about belonging, you know, yeah. Being part of the great human race. And yeah. So it's quite a spiritual, you know, using a Tibetan sound, it's quite a spiritual thing.
Yeah.
Listen, it's been great. Thank you very much, John, for taking
the
time.
Welcome.
I know you haven't been so good. So
no, it's okay. It's good. It's a good, you know, it's been nice to catch up, and it's, you know, it's good. And I mean, I'm more than, you know, it's been very happy. I was very flattered that you asked me. So thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. Well, it's a pleasure.
So yeah, out on the February the 5th, the two versions of the album, and so yeah, it's
and there's a 5.1 mix,
and there's a 5.1 mix for the 16th.
And there's an ultimate edition box set which has everything in it.
Right.
And so the album is available as vinyl, as digital. The vinyl versions have the digital with them.
Right.
You can download it, both versions as well. And if you buy the ultimate edition, you get everything, including a poster and a booklet, which has numerous pages, more than I can remember.
Yeah, but it's a visual feast.
Yeah, it's a burst. Yeah, it really is. And it's an amazing looking package as well.
Excellent.
So it's a good looking thing.
Excellent. Brilliant. Okay, well, should look forward to that. And good luck with it. And I hope that, well, in the not too distant future, our paths will cross again in person.
Yeah.
Once all this, you know, once I understand.
I'm going to say one thing to you. Keno.
Yes, Keno. Yes. Yes.
What do you think?
Yes.
Well, we should talk about this another time.
Shall we? Yes, absolutely. Let me, absolutely. Why not? Okay.
Pleasure. Cheers, John.
Cheers, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.